discussing about the moisture variables, right? And in that, we discussed about the definitions of the mixing ratio and the specific humidity, right? So do you remember what is the difference between the mixing ratio and the specific humidity? Can somebody say what is the difference between mixing ratio and a specific humidity? Tell me. So can you tell the difference between mixing ratio and a specific humidity? No, Alvin? Yeah, trying to say something? Go ahead. Alvin, silent.
Sir, I don't remember mixing ratio.
Yeah, define mixing ratio. What is mixing ratio?
So mixing ratio is the ratio of mass of water vapor to mass of dry air.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. And a specific humidity?
Sir, I don't remember.
Well, a specific humidity, almost the same.
Specific humidity is the mass of water vapor per unit mass. Per unit mass of moist air.
Moist air, correct. Yeah, moist air, right. And since the amount of water vapor in the air is much smaller compared to the dry air, so the mixing ratio and the specific humidity are almost the same. Okay, the value is almost the same, although very slightly maybe smaller. Specific humidity may be slightly smaller than compared to the mixing ratio, but they are almost the same. Also, the specific humidity is same as the density. Okay, is same as the density of water vapor. All right. So that we have discussed yesterday. Today we shall discuss some more moisture variables. All right. But before that, let us talk about the lifting condensation level more in detail. We have been talking about this lifting condensation level earlier, but let's talk about that more in detail today. Okay. So do you remember we had discussed about this lifting condensation level earlier in the class, little bit, not much detail, but do you remember what is this lifting condensation level? Can anybody say what is lifting condensation level? Yes or no? You remember or not? Everybody is silent. Okay, am I audible and visible clearly? Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Sir, you are visible, but yes, the voice is a bit late. That's why we are responding a little late.
Oh, I see. And are you able to see my profile picture or live picture?
No, sir. We are able to see you.
See what? Live picture or profile picture?
No, sir. See your live picture.
Live picture. Okay. Yeah. But my voice, you are saying, is slightly delayed. Yeah?
Yes, sir.
But now it is okay?
Yes, sir. Sometimes okay. It is happening and sometimes it is okay.
Okay. Maybe because of the fluctuation in the network. Okay. So, the lifting condensation level, as we had talked earlier also, is the level where the condensation starts taking place. Okay, you are raising a moist air. Initially, it may be unsaturated, right? But as it is lifted upwards, it will lose the temperature. And as the temperature decreases, the saturation mixing ratio will also decrease. And at certain point, when the temperature is low enough, then the condensation will start taking place. At that point, the air is completely saturated, and that level is called the lifting condensation level. Okay. So, in words, the lifting condensation level is defined as a level to which an unsaturated but moist parcel of air can be lifted adiabatically before it becomes saturated with respect to water. This is the definition of the lifting condensation level. Okay. Now let's see this diagrammatically in this figure. Now this figure is something similar to your one of the thermodynamic diagrams, okay, that we have discussed in detail in the previous classes. Now in this diagram, this is the pressure, okay. On the y-axis, you have got the pressure, and x-axis generally it is the temperature. Now from these lines, this line says that WS is constant. WS is the saturation mixing ratio. Okay. The standard symbol used for mixing ratio is W, omega or W you can say. So S indicates saturation. So WS is the saturation mixing ratio. Okay. This line, the saturation mixing ratio is constant along this line. Okay. Now this orange line that you see, here it says theta is constant. Theta is, what is theta stands for? What does theta stand for? Standard symbol. What does theta stand for? In the conventional symbol, what does theta stand for?
Angle.
What is that? Say again.
So I said angle.
No, I could not hear properly.
Sir,
Theta.
angle.
Well, it is not an angle here. In geometry, we say angle generally.
The geopotential height.
No, not geopotential height. Geopotential height
No, sir,
is
temperature.
which temperature? Which temperature? Because there are so many types of temperature in meteorology. Which temperature? Now, theta, you should remember that theta is generally used for potential temperature. Okay. Theta in meteorology or atmospheric science is generally used for potential temperature. Okay. Whereas the geopotential is denoted generally by phi. Okay. Geopotential is generally denoted by phi. Phi, say, I don't know whether I can write. Suppose this is theta. Oops. We try to write theta. No, didn't it? By she's trying to use the draw. It's not able to draw. I don't know. There was some provision to draw in the PowerPoint. Do you remember how to draw in the PowerPoint? Okay, just let me try. She's trying to test, different things in the PowerPoint. I hope the screen is visible clearly, right? The screen visible clearly?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I'm trying to draw. Let's see. Can you see this drawing? Are you able to see
Yes,
this?
sir.
Yeah,
Yes,
this
sir.
is theta, right? Now, theta is, as I said, for potential temperature. This is phi, right? This is used for geopotential. Okay, so you should remember these things. Standard, they are standard single symbols. Just like when you use U, what does this indicate generally?
Internal energy.
Well,
velocity.
Yeah, zonal velocity. Zonal, horizontal velocity, that means zonal component. This is?
Yes, sir.
Zonal component. Of velocity. I mean, there are standard symbols used in meteorology. Okay, when we use V, what does this indicate?
Meridional velocity.
Exactly, meridional component of the velocity, right? I mean, there are standard components. Now, W we use both for mixing ratio as well as also for vertical velocity. And this is always on the Z coordinate system. I mean, generally it is in the Z coordinate system. Okay. When it is a pressure coordinate system, we use omega, omega. This is the vertical velocity in peak coordinate. P is the pressure coordinate. You might be studying that in the dynamic meteorology. Okay, standard symbols, should always remember that. Okay, generally when we say gamma, that is for lapse rate of environment, surrounding air, environmental air, right? When we say gamma d, this is indicating what?
Dry
adiabatic lapse rate. And similarly, when we use gamma S, indicates who? Tell me.
Saturated.
Saturated, yeah, or moist adiabatic. Moist adiabatic. Batic lapse rate. Okay, so this is what we use conventionally, unless otherwise it is specified that okay, this symbol indicates that. These are the conventional symbols. Similarly, we also use Q for a specific humidity. Okay, we use the symbol Q for a specific humidity. Okay, they are standard symbols. All right. So, having said that, now let's go back to our original slide. We're discussing about the lifting condensation level. All right. Where was the lifting condensation level? Okay. So, am I visible live or my profile is visible now?
Yes, sir, you are visible, sir.
Okay, I'm visible. Not my profile, right? Profile picture.
No, sir.
Okay. So, lifting condensation level, as we said, is defined as the level to which an unsaturated but moist parcel of air can be lifted adiabatically before it becomes saturated with respect to water. And in this diagram, all this discussion came from this diagram. Okay. We're saying that this is the line of constant saturation mixing ratio. And this is the line of constant theta. Now, what is the line of constant theta? We have discussed this earlier in the Tiffy gram or thermodynamic diagram. What does this line of constant theta means? You have to remember these things. Anybody? What is the line of constant theta means?
Sir, isotherm.
No. Isotherms, temperatures are not conserved, right? Temperature is not a conserved quantity. Theta is a conserved quantity. Theta is a conserved quantity. Temperature is not a conserved quantity. We have discussed this earlier. The constant theta, that means this is dry adiabat. Dry adiabat. Okay. Dry adiabat. Okay. So, similarly, this is the constant mixing ratio line, also called the moist adiabat, you can say in this case. That means conserved. Mixing ratio is a conserved quantity. You know, sometimes you will have a multiple choice question. In the examination, you can have sometimes multiple choice question. Whether mixing ratio is a conserved quantity or not a conserved quantity. Okay. Similarly, whether theta is a conserved quantity or not a conserved quantity. Those things can be sometimes the objective type of questions. All right. So let us say a parcel of air is initially here and it has temperature of T, pressure at P, and mixing ratio W. Okay, initial value here. Then this is another point where the at the same pressure level is the same, let's say 1000 millibar, where the temperature is TD, the dew point. Okay, and this is saturation mixing ratio. Okay, so when we are lifting it upwards, when the parcel of air is lifted upward, okay, initially because this is unsaturated, so it will follow the dry adiabat. And the dew point, because it is like a saturation temperature sort of thing, which is always less than the actual temperature, will follow the moist adiabat. And both the lines, they cross each other at this place, at this point, which is, let us say, approximately 800 millibar, slightly more than the 800 millibar. So this is the level where T, it becomes equal to TD. The temperature has become equal to the dew point temperature, right? That means saturation has occurred at this point. And this point is called the lifting condensation level for the air at this level. So that means if the air at this level is lifted adiabatically, then it will reach or it will become saturated at this level, and this is called the lifting condensation level. Generally, this is the level where the base of the cloud occurs. That means cloud starts forming from this level onwards because saturation has reached here. So this is the base of the cloud generally. All right. So is that clear now? Yes or no? Everybody is silent.
Yes, sir.
My audio.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So during the lifting, the mixing ratio W and the potential temperature theta of the air parcel will remain constant, okay, along the two lines. But the saturation mixing ratio WS decreases until it becomes equal to W at this level. Okay. Therefore, the LCL is located at the intersection of the potential temperature line passing through the temperature T, okay, temperature T, and the pressure P of the air parcel, and the WS line that passes through the pressure P and the dew point TD of the parcel as shown in this figure. Okay. So there was the lifting condensation level. Now, what is wet bulb potential temperature? I had told you about this in one of the classes earlier. Can somebody remember what is the wet bulb temperature? How do we measure this wet bulb temperature by instrument? Somebody, anybody?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, the wet bulb temperature is measured using a thermometer, which is covered with soaked cotton or
okay,
something
better. Right, exactly. And because it is soaked by water, so the water gets evaporated and the temperature gets cooled down because of the evaporation, right? So the wet bulb temperature is always less than the dry bulb temperature. Okay, and the amount of evaporation will depend upon how much the air is unsaturated, how much the air is dry, right? If there is too much dry, if the air is too dry, that means there will be more evaporation, isn't it? And so more cooling. So that means in the dry air, the difference between the dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature will be too large. Okay, but if the air is saturated, then the difference between the dry bulb and wet bulb will be very small or almost equal. If it is saturated, it will become equal. Okay, so that is how we measure the wet bulb temperature. Okay, same thing we can also see graphically. The wet bulb temperature is measured, as you have said, with a thermometer, a glass bulb of which is covered with a moist cloth over which ambient air is drawn. Okay. The dew point temperature, by definition, is the temperature at which the dew starts forming. That means condensation has started taking place. Okay. In this case, the temperature of the air at this point is the dew point temperature because the condensation has started taking place. And it is always, when the air is dry, it is always less than T. But if it is saturated, then they become equal. So generally, TD is less than or equal to TW, which is the wet bulb temperature, and which is less than or equal to T. Okay, as long as the air is unsaturated. But if it is saturated, then TD becomes equal to T, equal to TW. All right? So latent heats, already you know about that, right? From your BSc study of the thermodynamics, isn't it? You know the latent heat. Yes or no? You have studied latent heat, right?
Yes,
my
sir.
Audible. Yeah, exactly.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you have studied latent heat earlier. So, by definition, let us say the latent heat of melting is defined as the latent heat that has to be given to a unit mass of air of a material to convert it from the solid to the liquid phase without a change in temperature. The temperature at which this phase change occurs is called the melting point. Like if you are heating ice, then it will start melting. Okay. So the amount of heat required to melt ice, right? Or the temperature at which the ice starts melting is the melting point temperature. And the latent heat that is required to melt the house, to melt the ice, is the latent heat of melting. Say at 1 atmospheric pressure and 0 degrees centigrade temperature, you may be knowing that latent heat of melting of the water substance is 3.34 times 10 power 5 joules per kilogram. This you must be knowing, must have studied earlier. The latent heat of freezing has the same numerical value as the latent heat of melting, but the heat is released as a result of the change in phase from liquid to solid. Okay. So one leads to warming and other leads to cooling. Right? One leads to warming, other leads to cooling. Keep in mind. How? If the ice is melted, then air gets cooled or warm. Tell me, if the ice is melted, if there is an ice in the air, suppose if you go up, have you heard about the cirrus cloud? Have you heard about the cirrus cloud?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, cirrus cloud. Cirrus clouds is basically made of ice particles, ice crystals, very high cloud. Right. Yeah. So if the ice is melted from the cirrus cloud, will the air be heated or cooled?
Sir, cool.
Cool, exactly. It will be cool. Exactly. It will be cool because the heat is drawn from the air to melt the ice. So air loses its temperature. Right. On the other hand, when there is a freezing, if the super cooled liquid water freezes, then the air will be heated or cooled.
Heated,
exactly, because heat is released, right? Already, liquid water is there, and then when it is frozen, when it releases latent heat, so it is cool. Similarly, the process for latent heat of condensation and evaporation, right? Almost same thing. During the condensation process, heat is released or cooled. Condensation, that means conversion from water vapor to liquid water, isn't it? Condensation, that means conversion of the phase from water vapor to liquid water, isn't it? Yes or no? Yes or no?
Yes,
yeah. So when the condensation is occurring, that means heat will be released or absorbed from the air. When the condensation is
absorbed,
so released.
It is released because when the water vapor is cool, okay, heat is released and the air, surrounding air gets heated. So, actually speaking, in the nature where rainfall occurs, that means the condensation of water vapor into liquid water, that's the raindrop. You will study that in more detail, the cloud microphysics. But for a layman's language, when the rainfall occurs, basically water vapor has condensed, right? Condensed into liquid form. And so the latent heat is released. And so that latent heat, where will it go? It will warm the air. It will warm the air. So air temperature will increase. Air temperature is supposed to increase because of the condensation. And reverse is the case when there is evaporation, right? When the evaporation takes place, that means when water droplets gets evaporated into water vapor, then heat is absorbed. And so air loses the temperature, air gets cooled. Okay. That you should be clear. You must have studied earlier. So this is what is said here. Similarly, the latent heat of vaporization or evaporation is the heat that has to be given to a unit mass of material to convert it from liquid to the vapor phase without a change in temperature. Okay. So for the water substance at 1 atmospheric pressure and 100 degrees centigrade temperature, that is the boiling point of water at 1 atmospheric pressure, the latent heat of vaporization is 2.25 times to about 6 joules per kilogram. This also you must be knowing. Must have studied in your BSc thermodynamics, right? The latent heat of condensation has the same value as the latent heat of vaporization, but heat is released in the change in phase from vapor to liquid. What I was trying to explain, right? So these things, these physical processes must be clear in your mind that when the air gets heated, when the air gets cooled, okay, by condensation, by evaporation, by melting, by freezing, etc., etc. Okay, and all these things take place in the atmosphere because of the change in phase, right? Inside the clouds, we have got so many types of cloud hydrometeors, you know, in different forms. There can be snow, there can be ice, there can be grapple, there can be hail, you know, hail storms, etc. Now, when the hail falls, okay, during the hail storm, that is basically a frozen substance, right, inside the cloud. So during all these phase changes, you know, all these things occur because of the change in phase inside the cloud, right? And we say the cloud microphysics, okay, at a very tiny scale, very, very tiny scale in terms of the micron, you know, it's a scale between micron, the size of a raindrop, maybe a few microns, right? Very small size, tiny droplets, right? Similarly, the size of the ice crystals, ice particles, are very tiny, maybe a few microns, okay, very, very small, snow crystals, ice crystals, size of a hail, initially it is too small, but by the time it falls down the to the ground, it becomes quite a big. Sometimes as big as, you know, in the record, as big as, I think, half a kilogram to 1 kilogram of hail has been found, recorded. And you just imagine, if 1 kilogram of substance falls onto your head from the air, what will happen? Your head will be broken, smashed, right? Such a heavy. And that's why the windscreens of the cars, you know, when the hail, very severe hailstorm occurs, can get broken, right? Glasses get broken. Yeah, glasses, windows can get broken. The wind, now the windscreen of the cars can get broken because of the very large size of the hail particles. But that large size has become only by the time it reaches the ground. You know, inside the cloud, it will be very smaller pellets, small pellets of hail particles. But it keeps growing. We shall study more in detail now in the cloud microphysics part of this course. Okay. So that is the freezing, melting, etc., etc. Now let's discuss about the saturated adiabatic and pseudo-adiabatic processes. Okay. Remember, this is very, very important. You must know what is the pseudo-adiabatic process, right? What is the saturated adiabatic process and what is the pseudo-adiabatic process? Very important, okay? You must know the difference. And this is very, very common process that occurs in the atmosphere, pseudo-adiabatic process. As the name implies, pseudo, that means it is not truly adiabatic. Pseudo-adiabatic, that means it is not truly adiabatic. It is falsely adiabatic, maybe, right? So what is this process? When air parcel rises in the atmosphere, its temperature decreases with altitude at the dry adiabatic lapse rate. We have discussed this earlier, until it becomes saturated with water vapor. Further lifting results in condensation of liquid water or the deposition of ice, okay, which releases the latent heat. Okay. Consequently, the rate of decrease in the temperature of the air parcel is reduced. Okay. Because of the condensation, because the latent heat has been released, air has been warm. If all the condensation products remain in the rising parcel, the process may still be considered to be adiabatic and reversible. You must have studied in your BSc thermodynamics the reversible process and irreversible process. Have you studied or not? Yes, studied. Or no? Studied, right? Reversible, yep. Process and irreversible process. So if all the condensate, all the condensation products remain hanging in the atmosphere, the process still may be reversible, even though latent heat is released in the system, provided that heat does not pass through the boundaries of the air parcel. Okay, provided the heat does not pass the boundary of the air parcel. Air parcel is then said to undergo a saturated adiabatic process. Okay. That means there is no heat exchange. The process is completely adiabatic. Okay. Entire condensate product has remained in the atmosphere itself. No. It has not fallen to the ground. Okay. So that process is a saturated adiabatic process. All right. However, if the condensation products immediately fall out of the air parcel, the process is irreversible and not strictly adiabatic. Like when the rainfall occurs, when the rain falls to the ground, that means the condensate or condensed products, they remain hanging in the air. I mean, they have fallen out of the atmosphere and come to the ground as rain, in the form of rain. So in that situation, the process is not completely reversible. It is irreversible because already the condensates have fallen to the ground, right? Air parcel is then said to undergo a pseudo-adiabatic process. Pseudo-adiabatic process. Therefore, the saturated adiabatic and the pseudo-adiabatic lapse rates are virtually identical. Okay, you must remember. What is pseudo-adiabatic process? And what is the difference between saturated adiabatic lapse rate and the pseudo adiabatic lapse rate? Okay, the both the lapse rates, whether it is saturated adiabatic lapse rate call or pseudo adiabatic lapse rate, they are identical. Okay, whereas the saturated adiabatic process and the pseudo adiabatic process are not the same. Okay, one is reversible. This is reversible, whereas this is irreversible. This is irreversible, right? So you must know these differences. Now let's derive an equation for the pseudo adiabatic process of a saturated air. Equation for a pseudo adiabatic process of saturated air. Now consider an air parcel of 1 gram of dry air and WS gram of saturated vapor. Okay, this is the mixing ratio, saturated mixing ratio. The initial state of this parcel is defined by, let's say, pressure P and temperature T. Okay, let's say in this diagram, initial state is defined by pressure at this point P and temperature at this point. This is isotherm. This is an isotherm. And this is also an isotherm at another temperature T plus delta T. Okay. Another isotherm T plus delta T. So let us say a parcel of air is defined initially at this point A having pressure P and temperature T. How do I write on this one? Can I write on this one? I don't know. If I want to write, then I have to. Out of this, maybe. And let's see, is this diagram visible to you? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay, so if I want to write on this one, let's say this is a state of a parcel having pressure at P and temperature at T. Okay. Now let's say if we lift the parcel from this point A, let us say this is point A, to the point B, where the pressure has decreased because P is increasing this way. So let's say at this point, the pressure has become P minus delta P and temperature has become T minus delta T. Let's say this is a capital T. Okay. This is the state of the parcel when you are lifting this from point A to point B. Okay. Let it undergo a small adiabatic expansion to the state P plus dP, where delta P is actually negative in this case, P minus delta P. And delta T also dT is negative, P minus delta T, because temperature has decreased. And WS plus DWS with the change in the saturation mixing ratio, where dP, dT, and DWS are negative because they are minus here. This is represented graphically in this figure. Okay. The condensation of minus DWS, because we said that the mixing ratio, saturation mixing ratio, omega S, sorry. Oops. Oops. It becomes so sensitive. I'm not even touching the drawing board, but what happened? Anyway, I think I'm just wasting my time. Let's see. Okay, so here the mixing ratio also has decreased by the amount DWS gram of water vapor. So the condensation of this much of gram of water vapor releases a quantity of heat equal to L times DWS, where L is the latent heat of condensation. This amount heats the moist air. Okay. Since WS is much smaller than 1, okay, as we have seen earlier, discussed earlier, that the value of mixing ratio or the saturation mixing ratio is measured in terms of what is the unit? Can somebody say what is the unit of mixing ratio? What is the unit of mixing ratio? Who can say?
Sir, it has no unit. Sir.
No unit, sir.
Yeah, it is dimensionless, but you can express it in terms of kilogram per kilogram. Right, or gram per kilogram, right? Kilogram per kilogram or gram per kilogram. But still, the value is so small, much smaller than the one, right? WS is much smaller than the one, because in 1 kilogram of moisture, there may be just a point something, you know, kilogram or point something gram of the dry air, I mean, water vapor. So, since this is much less than 1, the amount of heat taken up by the remaining vapor is small compared to that taken up by the dry air. Okay. Hence, let us assume that all the heat goes into 1 gram of dry air. And so, from the first law of thermodynamics, we can write, from the first law of thermodynamics, if you know, just recall this equation, this is basically a first law of thermodynamics written in this form. Work done, right? Change in temperature minus this term. Okay. So L times DWS, L is the latent heat of condensation. Change in the saturation mixing ratio equal to a specific heat of the dry air. You can say change in temperature minus R star gas constant T divided by MD. Right. So this is the mass of the dry air times change in the P minus P. Yes. Where ES is the saturation water vapor pressure, this is the pressure of the air divided by P minus ES. Okay, this is from the first law of thermodynamics. Let's say this is 23.1. This equation is the differential relation between P and T, pressure and temperature, during a pseudo-adiabatic process. During a pseudo-adiabatic process, this equation represents the relationship between the pressure and the temperature based upon the first law of thermodynamics. You see the application of first law of thermodynamics now here during the pseudo-adiabatic process. Okay. Now this equation may be simplified further by neglecting ES, the saturation vapor pressure, compared to the P, because compared to the surface pressure, the air pressure, the ES is much, much smaller. And so we can ignore that, we can neglect that from equation. ES can be ignored because ES is much smaller than P, wherever the combination of P minus ES occurs. Okay, this is too small a term. And so we can write L times DWS by T equal to Cp dT by T minus R star by, this is MD star dP by P. Okay, let's say this is equation number 23.2. Now, logarithmic differentiation of the Poisson equation. Now, who can say what is Poisson equation? You remember Poisson equation? Tell me what is Poisson equation? Nobody remembers Poisson equation. Everybody is silent. Anjali, what is Poisson equation?
Sir?
What is Poisson equation?
Theta is equal to?
Yes. Yes.
T.
Yes. Yes.
T into P0 by P raised to R by Cp.
P0 by P raised to R by Cp. Correct. Yeah, that is the equation of potential temperature, also known as Poisson equation.
Poisson's equation.
Yeah, exactly. This is the one. This is what exactly you have said, right? So, the logarithmic differentiation of this Poisson equation yields this equation. Okay. Cp d theta by theta is equal to Cp times dt by t minus R divided by Md times dp by p. Just take a logarithm on both sides and differentiate. Therefore, the equation of stereoadiabatic process may be written as from 23.2 and this from these two equations as L dWs by T is equal to Cp theta by theta. This is the equation for the pseudo-adiabatic process. Okay. Let's say this is equation number 23.4. Since dWs is negative, condensation has occurred. Okay, the moist air has lost its moisture, water vapor, during an expansion. So 23.4, this equation shows that during a pseudo-adiabatic expansion, the potential temperature is not conserved, remember, okay, but increases. It is due to the fact that latent heat is released. So that means, although potential temperature is a conserved parameter, but during a pseudo-adiabatic process, the potential temperature is not conserved, but it increases, right? Because whatever is the condensate, the condensation products, they have all fallen down to the ground in the form of rain, okay? So the potential temperature is not conserved and it increases with height, okay? The temperature continues to decrease during the expansion so that the condensation takes place. But this process, this decrease is less than for the unsaturated air. Okay, because of the moist adiabatic lapse rate, follows the moist adiabatic lapse rate. Okay, so in other words, suppose again going back to let us say new slide. Suppose you have a I don't know why it becomes so sensitive. And how to control this? Okay, so I'm still practicing how to use this pane on the drawing thing. Suppose this is your x and y axis, and this is a temperature or theta. Okay, and this is the pressure, which is decreasing towards the ground. So when you draw the temperature in the vertical, generally the temperature is supposed to decrease or increase with height. Let's say this is 0, this is 10, this is 20, this is 30, and this is minus 10, minus 20, minus 30, let us say. So when you draw the temperature in the vertical, will it decrease or increase? Everybody silent. Tell somebody. Temperature? When you draw the temperature,
the temperature decreases with height.
Decreases, right? Decreases. Right? So it will look something like this. Isn't it? This will be the temperature. Supposed to decrease with height. Somewhere it may remain constant even in the isothermal layer. Somewhere it may increase because it is an inversion layer. This is how temperature will increase. But if you plot the theta, the potential temperature, the potential temperature, you will find that it will increase with height. This is the theta. Got it? This is the temperature, and this is the This is the trying to practice this. Okay. So this is the temperature line and this is the potential temperature line. So theta is increasing with height because of the pseudo adiabatic process. Theta is increasing with height because of the pseudo adiabatic process, right? Whereas T is decreasing simply. Okay. But if it is a dry adiabatic process, with a dry adiabatic process, then the potential temperature will remain the same. It will be conserved. As we discussed earlier, during a dry adiabatic process, the potential temperature is conserved. Right? It will not change. Whereas in the pseudo adiabatic temperature, it will change. And the potential temperature is increasing with height, whereas the temperature is decreasing with height. If you draw the, suppose something similar in a diagram, your dry adiabatic adiabates would look like this one, right? Generally, this is the dry adiabates line, theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, theta 4, so on, right? So is it clear? Yes or no? Everybody is silent.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir.
Yeah. And mind you, this is the pressure. So even adiabates, I mean, isobars will be something similar. Isobars may be similar, more vertical. This may be slightly slanted. This theta 1 lines may be slightly slanted. Isobars will be horizontal because this is generally this is a logarithmic pressure. As you remember from the thermodynamic diagram, this is a logarithmic pressure. Okay. So all right, I think we have to we'll stop here today. Already 1:35. So today we shall stop here. Okay. So any question for today?
Yes, sir. Me.
Yeah. Tell me. There was this.
So I joined late.
Oh, I see. Your attendance, you mean? Huh? Okay, attendance will be counted. Okay. Anybody else? Anybody else? Nobody. I said, any question for today's talk, today's discussion?
No, sir.
No. Okay, fine. So we'll stop sharing PowerPoint. We'll stop the class. All right. Shall meet tomorrow. Okay. I see that only 10 students are there. I don't know why others are not coming. So I'll stop the recording also. Stop recording.